Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to welcome you and thank you for attending the first of many Science Fridays on Tygerberg campus. Science Fridays were birthed by Crest, and in the context of our campus, they're about creating a space for all Tygermartis to come together and engage about issues that are at the interface of science and society. Today, I am pleased to welcome an exceptional scientist who needs no introduction, being the recipient of the NRF Award for Distinguished Young Black Scientist, as well as the T.W. Kampule NRF Award for 2010-2011, which is basically the Oscars of science. When she started at the Department of Botany and Zoology at Stellenbosch, Prof. Knox was the first black female lecturer in the science faculty, and in 2014, she was promoted to associate professor level. Her research focuses on the application of biotechnology to Cape medicinal flora. She has supervised over 20 honor students, graduated 10 MSc students, and 3 PhD, and is also a NRF Y-rated scientist. When she isn't doing research, she somehow finds the time to serve on the executive committee of the South African Association for Botanists and was the young scientist president of the association. From humble beginnings in microbiology and biochemistry in Natal to being handpicked to represent South Africa internationally, ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Prof. Knox Makunga.
Don't feel worthy. Thank you so much, and thank you for the invite. I really appreciate it. So I'm going to get straight into it and get us into social media. So I'm taking a picture before I get it going. And I was actually asked to give a talk today about how one can actually communicate their science. And I'm going to focus most of this talk actually on using various social media platforms. And then thereafter, I'm going to launch us into a little bit of what it is that I actually do. And hopefully, I'll be able to highlight for you how this has actually helped my particular research. And so to get us going, I think we need to be tweeting, interacting with Facebook and all these other different platforms. And actually tomorrow UNESCO celebrates Women in Science. So I think this is quite apt. And so Science Friday, Women in Science, all those hashtags. And I actually am spending more time on Twitter than I do on any other social platform, even though I am on the others. And so I'm quite happy if you follow me, and I'm prepared to follow you as well. So my Twitter handle is at Knox the Lion, and I'm going to just talk about this and why particularly Knox the Lion. I happen to be a Leo, some people might have heard the story before. And then also my surname Makunga actually has got East African origin, and I don't know if any of you ever saw Madagascar 2.
Yes.
You remember Makunga the Lion? So there we go, so hence Makunga the Lion. So, I think most of us are quite well aware, especially if we are doing science, that you either publish or you perish. And this is the traditional way in which people have communicated their research for many years. And actually, it allows you to have this traction of going from a postgraduate student and ultimately into postdoc and hopefully launching you into a scientific career. And when I was at UKZN, my professor at the time, that was his favorite saying. Every tea time, how are you doing? How are your papers doing? And then you need to get published, otherwise you're not going to be able to make it. And most of us probably sitting in this room might be feeling a little bit of this kind of tension. I've got to put together this massive book. I've got to put together this thesis. And that's what you are mainly thinking about. So yes, there are different ways of communicating our science, and scientific publications have a very important role, because in essence, this is how you track your scientific career. And even if you're wanting to step out of science per se and actually get into industry, it's still important to have those scientific publications. But yes, absolutely, our world has actually changed, and changed in many different ways, because we're much more connected to the rest of the world through social media. And actually, social media and social visibility is becoming more and more important for actually walking up on those steps and ultimately actually building a career. And some people are even doing research in this area in terms of how social visibility actually affects impact factor and how it can actually sort of bolster the career of a scientist. So now, just to track back, two very socially visible ladies. Do we know who they are? Yeah, people say yes. Okay, great. So we've got Jeannie D and we've got Wanang. They've got many followers. I think Wanang is over 1 million. I'm not sure where Jeannie is. And so if we try and take a look at Twitter and what's actually been happening with Twitter and which people from South Africa are really socially visible. Trevor Noah, who's now sitting in the US, an incredible Twitter following. When he says something, the rest of the world is actually starting to listen. And I was quite surprised to see this guy, Casper Lee. I've never heard of this person until I started to track to see what's actually happening here. And apparently, he's a South African that happens to be a YouTube star. Only found out for the first time when I actually looked, and he's got an incredible following. The rest of the people, as you can see, some sports people, news agency, and obviously Bonang. Very visible. So what does this really mean? Well, actually, this kind of social visibility really can encourage younger people to be interested in science, because that is one of the ways in which to engage with them. So, like I said, when Trevor says something, the world listens. When Wanang tweets, South Africa listens. And that means that many other young people are actually listening to Wanang when she actually says something. So it really has an impact. So if you look at this, you can see which platforms are really important amongst young people. And you can, Instagram has certainly grown. So lots of pictures on Instagram have been loaded, and it's certainly amongst the most popular nowadays. But those are the statistics for the United States. And actually, if you look at Facebook, you can see how many people on Facebook, 1.7 billion people active on Facebook. And actually, Facebook happens to be the platform that most South Africans engage in. So one might think, how does this actually relate to my science? And how does it really assist me in actually tracking my academic life all the way through and ultimately getting a promotion or securing a particular job? And recently, these kinds of different social networking platforms are actually becoming also important tracking mechanisms for scientists. So I don't know if you guys were aware, but last week, Actual Living Scientist was trending on Twitter, and it was really amazing to see the different types of sciences that are actually being conducted. And this was sparked off by American scientists who are actually getting rather frustrated by the perception of science in the new government in the USA. And so it's really important in terms of scholarly metrics, because some people in academia are actually starting to utilize your social visibility as one of these metrics to track what's actually happening with academics in the world. So I showed you some pictures of two ladies who are very socially visible, and now I want to ask the question of, do we know who these people are? Yes? So one person, but previously when I asked about Jeannie and I asked about Wanang, just about everybody in this room nodded. So these happen to be our Jeannie D's and our Wanangs of South African women science. So, just going to give you a little bit of detail who they are. Professor Nyokong from Rhodes University. She studies nanochemistry. She's got a very interesting history. She was born actually in Lesotho, and at some stage she used to hurt G. And now she is an A-rated scientist. She won the TWAS Award last year for science. And she has a really large school that is obviously interested in building all kinds of different chemicals which are important. And then we have Dr. Kumalo, who happens to be a laser physicist from University of KwaZulu-Natal. And that's a picture of her giving a TED talk. I didn't say TEDx, TED. In the United States, on how laser physics technology can actually deliver and target antiretroviral medicines. Just said that and I actually got goosebumps. I think that is big. And last but not least, I had to put in a plant scientist, of course, Prof. Jill Farrant, and she actually used to be the face of L'Oreal. At some stage, Prof. Farrant, her picture was all over Charles de Gaulle, and she had won the L'Oreal Woman Scholar of the Year. And we don't even know who these people are, and they actually sit right on our doorsteps. And I feel that just as much as Bonang is an inspiration to younger women, and just as much Jimmy D might be an inspiration to younger women, these ladies are just as inspirational to a broader society because they bring science into the public space and they just show how science can actually add value to our lives. And unfortunately, most of us don't even know who they are. So just as a little bit of a break, I think I quite like that. Professor, you've written an outstanding tale about the emergence of modern man. What are your sources? Facebook. And most people, I think, are actually interacting with Facebook, not just because they've got all their friends there, they've got their moms there, and they want to see what people are doing, but it's become a very important source of information. Some people, when they read the news, go into their Facebook feed, and that's where they get their news from. And so these different platforms are an incredible way of disseminating information. And if we look at Facebook and its reach in terms of Africa, it is the most utilized platform. These stats are probably a little bit old now. This is 3 years ago, so there's probably been some growth. But this is the amount of people in 2013 that we're actually interacting with Facebook. So different ways of social interaction can actually have quite a lot of reach. And we have all kinds of different social media platforms. It's difficult to choose which one to utilize. I say choose the one that works for you. And for me, I get a little bit frustrated sometimes with Facebook because I'm seeing too much noise. People's vacations, people's incredible lives, hiking, etc. And so I use Twitter as my main social media platform. But there are all kinds of different platforms that are actually available to us. So now I just want to give you guys a bit of a feeling of how scientists can actually use social media. So Dr. Atanasov is actually a professor that's in Austria, and he is very social. He's got a Twitter profile hidden here at the background. He's on Instagram, he's on Facebook, he's on all of it. And every single platform, he utilizes it to disseminate science. He doesn't have any pages where moms and dads and aunts and uncles are following, maybe he does, but every single one is actually targeted to promoting his science. And at some stage, he actually published one of his papers about how important it is to have a graphical abstract in terms of your paper. And this was taken up as a conversation amongst other scientists. So yes, there's ways not only to inspire other people into science through social media, but it's also a way of communicating with other scientists. I have never met Dr. Tanasov, but we've met via Twitter. And interestingly enough, he works on an area that I'm interested in, natural products. And at some stage, we DM'd each other, direct messaged via Twitter, and then swapped emails and are actually now preparing a review article together. So I've met somebody via social media that's in the same area as me, and we are now collaborating and actually striking up scientific networks. It also opens me up to his network. So there really is space for all of this. And like I said, he is on every single platform. So he utilizes just about everything that is actually there. All right, so people are actually starting to do research in this era, as I said before. And there are certain features of social media which are actually becoming quite important. Firstly, it opens up the rest of the world to what scientists are actually doing. People don't know what we do in our laboratories, and they actually have a fear often that we might be doing things that are not necessarily right. And so, if we are able to explain to the world what it is that we're doing, then people have got an idea of what we're doing, so they actually care what it is that we are actually doing. And then they're also able to get involved. And if you look at that little paragraph, you actually diagnosed some of the sentences there, you'll see 57% of people are online, and they're actually talking to other people in the US. And also, interestingly enough, is that most Americans, apparently, which is one of the reasons we had the actual living scientist trending last week, they don't actually know scientists. They've never met a true living scientist. And so it really allows several different things. It allows you to be active socially, interesting, and other people to become interested in you. And also what I think is important is that when you are interacting with the general public, you also need to be humble in your interactions. And last but not least, when you are interacting, I think you need to be really careful about being unprofessional so that you don't end up in trouble. So I'm quite careful with my Twitter and my tweets, because I would still like my job. I don't want to get in trouble with the university. So yes, I tweet things that I'm interested in, but I am never defamatory when I actually tweet. And honesty is also very important. So ask other scientists using social media in the workplace, and the answer to that would be yes. And many people are using different kinds of social media, and this was actually a paper on how many scientists actually tweet and what kind of responses are they actually tweeting. What is it that they're actually tweeting? So this is a whole new field in terms of looking at the impact of social media on our society as a whole. So what is it that academics are actually tweeting? And most of the time, it is generally dialogue between other scientists and also the public. What I think is quite important here is they're also talking to funders who have the potential to be able to fund their research. And I think money is tight for everybody, and often people are even crowdfunding their research using different social media platforms. As an example, at Kew Gardens, there's a study on Allo, And this was a crowdfunded project, and it was initiated last year. And I also know a friend of mine who came to the end of her PhD funding, and last year she actually sent out quite a few tweets and social media, and she basically got crowdfunded to complete her work on rhinos last year. So there are many opportunities, and these opportunities are not necessarily science to science links, but being able to communicate with people that can have all kinds of other impacts. So this past week I've been writing an article on women in science, and I came across through that. And this is a paper that's written by Bradley Bond. He is a social scientist, and he basically studies how science is influencing young people. And I quite like this from fairy godmothers, because as a young girl, this is what is generally in your world. But then somewhere in the middle, somebody expects you to have an interest in science, take maths and science, and then ultimately end up making robotics. And so there's really a disconnect here. And this paper basically summarizes it by saying that influences such as television have actually got a large impact on decisions that young women make about maths and science, and even careers. And those decisions are actually made earlier on while they are still 5 and 6. And for me, I think that's quite shocking, because part of this paper illustrates that exposure to roles of men who are in the sciences, but non-exposure of women in roles that happen to be in the sciences, creates a stereotype. And this stereotype makes young girls believe that they can't actually do maths and science. And that's really worrying. So the messages that we need to be communicating from the very start is to empower younger people, even girls of 4 and 5, that yes, you can be doing medical physiology as a woman. Okay, so just to carry on with this, so social media done right can have an impact on young people and can have an impact in terms of our society. It allows us to be open-minded, it allows us to be able to brainstorm, and it also allows us to be able to interact with our colleagues. And so it can be a very powerful way of disseminating our information. And so there really is space in order to be able to communicate science using various social media platforms. And sometimes there's controversy. I don't know if you remember Distractingly Sexy. So that was a real issue. So it really needs to be done right. And I'm not going to go into too much detail about that. And I think that controversy is all too familiar to all of us in terms of Tim Noakes getting into trouble and then a lawsuit. So we do need to be careful. Okay, so visibility is important, but social media is not the only platform. Print media is also pretty important because it can actually create an interaction with those funders that I actually spoke about. So I work on medicinal plants, and a few years ago there was actually an article written in the Business Day about this work, and this actually facilitated us interacting with funders who actually would be the types of people that would be reading a business newspaper. At the same time, I think for me, it took me from giving a TEDx talk in Stellenbosch to these NSTF awards, obviously science in between that needs to be done, and ultimately engaging with different companies as a brand educator. And this is actually a really long journey from where my family actually comes from. So that is the view outside of my dad's village. And
It's a journey that's basically taken me all the way from the middle of nowhere, Eastern Cape, to giving talks at women's breakfast, champagne breakfasts in places like Sandton. So I think it is important to disseminate that information. It's not necessarily easy because you have to juggle this together with your academic life, and there are other costs in terms of your academic life. We have to publish, we have to teach, and as well as interacting with our community. So these are all real struggles in terms of the academic career. So ladies and gentlemen, now I'm going to switch it up a little bit and actually talk a bit more about what work it is that I actually do. And so the last part of this presentation will then be focused to give you a feeling in terms of the kind of work that I'm actually doing on the other side of the N1 in Stellenbosch. And yes, I work with medicinal plants. And what's been interesting is this research has really grown in terms of its profile in South Africa. And these data are quite interesting because you see much less in the 90s and then the sudden boom. And this boom is actually similar to what is happening in the rest of the world. So the kind of research that people are doing internationally is really focused on biochemistry, genetics, and molecular biology. And if you look and track medicinal research in South Africa, you will see that we are here, that little green line, and that's the global line. And the other bricks are sitting over there. So there's really quite a lot of opportunities, particularly with the understanding of South Africa has got an incredible flora. So my last two stories is just to highlight a little bit of my research, and then this will then bring this presentation to an end. And the reason I put together this set of slides is because we are in the medical arena, and so I'd like to talk about a project that we've been working on that has got a medical feeling. And we do this together with the other physiologists on our campus. This is Prof. Annemarkt Engelbrecht and her team, and we've been working on this particular research. So most of you might be aware that 80% of our population is still reliant on traditional medicines. And if you look and dissect the stats, you will see that people are interacting with traditional healers much more than they are with doctors. And this is because there are more traditional healers in our society than there are physical doctors. 1 to 500, 1 to 40,000. So there's quite a large disparity in terms of accessing a medicine for South Africans. And these medicines are consumed by many different people, 27 million people. That's a lot of people that are interacting with traditional medicines and the traditional medicine system continuously all the time. And so some of our research is actually focused on understanding the importance of traditional medicines to people, and also adding a new value to that medicine by examining it and testing it to see if it actually works. So one of the projects that I've been working with is together with a group of Cape Bush doctors, and they led us to a combination of plants which was important for treating coughs and colds. And then we took that set of plants and passed it through an anti-cancer bioassay. And we were really surprised to see that the one species actually was very effective in terms of breast cancer. So just to unpack the data here, you've got the extract that we actually utilized. And then you've got your docs, doxorubicin, which is used as a chemotherapy. And when you take a look at this, you can see the extract in the breast cancer cell model is actually much more effective than the docs. So we think that we're really onto something here. So some people say, well, maybe it's just killing everything. So then what we did was we looked to see if the normal breast epithelial cell will also react, and it has the same effect as docs. And docs is commercialized, our extract is not. So the cytotoxicity is actually equal to industry standards. Okay, so then we wanted to see if it works in vitro, does it work in vivo? And we fed some mice which had been injected with the cancer, and we treated these with our extract. And what was quite interesting was that not only did the extract decrease the size of the tumors, but the mice carried on gaining weight. And this is not your normal scenario in terms of chemotherapy, because most chemotherapy actually leads to a decrease in terms of weight mass. So there's something in this extract that's not only killing the cancer, but at the same time is able to maintain the physiology within a living system, or the health within a living system. So we are interested in elucidating what this may be, but at the same time, the Rastafarian healers said, we only collect in Stellenbosch, and we only collect the plants that are actually sitting right at the top of the mountain. And as a scientist, I kept on thinking, how does that work? Because how do you know that those plants are more effective than any other plants? And so we used a strategy where we actually look at the chemistry to try and understand the differences in populations. And so if you look, the Rastas went collecting, they got plants that grew from the site that they said was effective, and plants that grew from sites which were much lower down, and we could actually separate out the plants that were growing at a higher altitude. So yes, they were onto something. And they also said, well, Stellenbosch has got the best population, and we actually looked to see, and indeed, Stellenbosch turned out to have a population that was actually grouping separately from the other populations. And when we did the MTT assays, we did find that Stellenbosch was more effective than the other plant populations which we had collected from Dihwop and Cedarberg. So is this really a tangible effect which we can track and assay using a variety of apoptotic cancer markers? Yes, indeed, the extract does cause apoptosis, and we are able to detect several different apoptotic markers that are linked to the efficacy of the extract. So we were also interested to see whether this extract, if collected from various other populations that are close to Stellenbosch, if the plants had the same chemistry. And what was really interesting is that, again, the Stellenbosch population was sitting in a separate place from the rest of the plants that we had collected, all the way from Paarl and right up until Somerset West. So there's something that is either genetically distinct or reliant on the microclimate that is making the Stellenbosch population quite unique. And so plants can be very variable in terms of their effectiveness, and seasons can have an impact. Year-to-year variation can also have a large impact. And what was really surprising for us was that the 2015 population actually seemed to be extremely active, and we had to now do new work to determine the concentration of this particular 2015 collection. And it is extremely potent, where we were still getting a hit with an extract that was 0.125 milligrams per liter, which was much more effective, actually, than even the DOCS. So some people say, well, Knox, you are testing an ethanolic extract, and in traditional medicine, people use water to actually take this medicine. Yes, so we did that work, and we could still show that even the aqueous extract is far more effective compared to DOCS. And when we combine the DOCS and we combine it together with the extract, it lowers the activity of the extract alone, but it is still effective. And the reason we wanted to do this kind of work is because we are thinking that this extract might be an interesting way to assist as an adjuvant for the treatment of breast cancer. Okay, so getting very close to the end of this talk, and I just want to share, just bring it together and say, yes, I do work with local researchers, but at the same time, I also work with a suite of international researchers. And some of these people have actually come towards my path because of interactions that I may have had with regards to social media. And so we really live in a sharing economy, and social media platforms have the potential to be able to bring different scientists together. So the work that I spoke about in my last set of slides, this work has now actually grown from a project which was just Stellenbosch based, but we are actually now doing work with scientists that happen to be in Europe, and even scientists that actually happen to be in the US. And with those last words, I'd like to thank you all for your attention.